I'm Julian Togelius, or Julian Togelius, whichever you want. And I represent New York University and Model.ai. Perttu suggested the title, The Future of AI in Games, and I said, great, I can do something about this. Let's see what happens. I was told I'm going to have a mixed audience. So who here is from the game industry, broadly speaking? That side of the room. Okay, good. So who here is like from academia, broadly speaking, faculty, student, something? That side of the room. Okay, interesting. We have like a setup for a civil war here. Great. No, but so I know who I'm speaking to. So let me start with this recent Wired article. Generative AI won't revolutionize game development just yet. Was the title of this Wired article. Hipsters say artificial intelligence would one day automate all the hard work of video game creation. But it's not that simple. And they cite this weirdo guy. Even those advocating for generative AI in video games think a lot of the excited talk about machine learning in the industry is getting out of hand. It's ridiculous, says Julian Togelius, co-director of the MVU Game Innovation Lab, who has authored dozens of papers on the topic. Sometimes it feels like the worst kind of crypto bros left the crypto ship as it was sinking and then came over here and were like, generative AI, start the hype machine. And I just got clap here from like, you know, co-inventor of one of the most widely used generative AI tools. So, right, there we go. So the message is kind of complex. AI in various ways is changing the game industry and will change the industry, and there is a lot of stuff coming. Is my audio cutting in and out? Okay. Not sure what to do about it. Can try to move less. but basically, it's complex, and there are so many things that AI can be used for in so many ways, but the kind of use cases you think about first are not typically the ones which are easy to do. So before I go further, a quick introduction. Who am I? So I grew up in Malmö in Sweden. Så vi tar gästen det här föredraget på svenska. Sorry, no. Don't worry. That's all. And I finished high school, even though I almost flunked mathematics and didn't want to do anything which had anything to do with math afterwards. Last place I could imagine myself being is an engineering school. So I studied philosophy and psychology so I could understand the mind. And I didn't understand the mind. I realized to understand minds, I need to build minds. So I sort of gradually kind of came back into the technical field so I could do, I wanted to do biologically inspired artificial intelligence. And I wanted to do evolutionary robotics, evolving neural networks that could control robots. And that was great, except when you get to the point that robots are really slow, fragile, annoying, and all kinds of things. You have to sort of change tires and the battery state affects everything. And basically, you know, it's like really slow and annoying stuff. So I realized you could use video games for the same things, evolve neural networks that play video games. So that's kind of what I did for my PhD. And then I realized at around the same time, you could turn it around. Instead of using these games to test the AI algorithms, you could use AI algorithms to try to improve games, like maybe design the games for you in various ways. And that's what I then somehow built a career on. So I used to say that and I was moving around the world in various places. I am now in New York, and it's a good place to be. High energy, I like it. I think I'm staying there, but you know, it's pros and cons. So I used to say that I ask both what AI can do for games and what games can do for AI. Often, a particular project kind of touches on both, but there are different questions. So basically, I always start with something like this. This is John McCarthy, one of the founders of artificial intelligence, playing chess sometime in the 60s with a computer the size of a room. This is back in the 1960s when the world was in black and white. Computers were the size of a room, everyone was properly dressed and only white men existed. The world has changed. And chess was one of these games that people used as a testbed for artificial intelligence until we beat it. And then we had Go, and then we beat Go, and now we're basically done with these classic board games, and we have a lot of other interesting things to do. So we have had like a lot of games in AI research. But in game development, what we have is that the parts of a video game, now I have to watch my words here because like these two sides of the room can kill me in different ways. The parts of a typical video game, which you call the AI of the game, is what most people think about, in particular in industry terminology, is the whatever it is that controls the non-player characters. Now, that part does not really use artificial intelligence as defined in academia. Instead, what we have is a lot of navigation, so navigation algorithms, typically some version of best first search on some kind of graph structure, and fancy finite state machines that are called behavior trees. I hope no one is going to kill me for, especially from that side of the room, for saying this, but this is more or less where we are. So for some values of AI, AI is not used in the particular role of controlling NPCs in games. Same thing goes for game for most parts of game development and testing. We'll get to that there are actually some parts of video game development where a lot of AI is being used, even like modern machine learning and other kind of fancy things. But there are a lot of the kind of obvious roles where it's not happening. However, the revolution is coming. And I made this slide originally for a talk I was giving at Electronic Arts last year or the year before or something. And maybe I should just use this slide for the rest of the talk. No, I do have some videos and stuff. But this is basically what I think is going to happen. We have parts where, which are kind of low-hanging fruits, where in game development, we really do have AI involvements. Analytics in particular. Anyone who does a live game these days, and basically all games are live games in one way, they're doing some kind of analytics. They're at the very least doing churn prediction. They're probably doing other things as well. game testing, it is happening. More and more studios are using some kind of, even simple, AI of some kind of game testing, but it's going to happen more and more. It's kind of a low-hanging fruit for several reasons. One of the things is you do it offline. If it breaks down, it doesn't ruin your game. And runtime PCG, some kind of procedural content generation, is happening in a lot of games already. And techniques are getting more sophisticated and more interesting. Then more things are happening. Player imitation is imitating player behavior from data is something that's been worked on for a long time in academia. There are examples, there are games based on this that came out like 20 years ago, like Black and White and so on. But things are getting more mature here as well, and it's going to affect many things. There should be an arrow up here to game testing as well. Player experience modeling is also getting a lot more mature now that there's so much more data available. Basically, modeling what kind of effective state a particular game scenario is putting you in. Player adaptive PCG, generating content to fit players based on your prediction of what they can do and what they will feel. Again, an academic research topic for a long time, and again, something that I think will come, not in the first wave, maybe not in the second, maybe in the third. Better NPCs, this is what everybody's talking about. I resisted adding an LLM kind of thing here, because that's kind of a separate topic, large language model-driven NPCs. But even without them, we're going to get better NPCs that way. Game balancing, helping you balance games with better analytics, better NPCs, we can do that. Mixed initiative procedural content generation. Doing content generation both for most games during development time and for some games that are built on content generation in runtime together with an algorithm and having a two-way flow of control back and forth. And then basically, in the end here, what we call it, full lifecycle, all aspect, AI-driven game production. Now, here's me with a hype. At least this is a bit more nuanced hype. but this is basically where I see, if we're talking about the future of AI in games, here's my slide, can I go home now? No. Now we're going to dig into a bunch of specifics. And feel free, I guess, at the question at Q&A afterwards to absolutely skewer me for things I said here and elsewhere. Here's a slide that the CEO of the company I co-founded asked me to include. The CEO of the company I co-founded is also my former PhD student, which is an interesting thing. It's like, you know, he's my boss. I was his boss. Who's a boss anyway? why would we do these things? Lower risk of production, because, hey, you have AI testing and AI assistance in sort of developing things. Lower time to market, lower total cost of ownership, more time for creativity, less rote manual labor. Some of these things are straightforwardly true. For example, there are like PCG approaches that everybody uses for generating vegetation and some aspects of environments that simply gets rid of a bunch of boring manual labor so you can concentrate on more interesting stuff. And it's already in use for some kind, and it's been in use for quite some time for some kinds of content. Question is, what other kinds of content can we bring it to, and so on. This is kind of stuff you show to business people. The other why slide is like, wow, can we do completely new types of games this way? Can we do like crazy stuff that we never heard of? One thing I keep saying, and I believe it, is that, and some people disagree with, but it's always interesting to have a discussion about it, is that most templates for game design we have, most of the game genres we have, came from time before we had modern AI, before we had machine learning and modern tree search algorithms and so on, and modern optimization, and before we had consumer hardware that could run it reasonably fast. So basically, all these conventions from first-person shooters, role-playing games, strategy games, and so on, are there to sort of circumvent the lack of AI. And I believe that to really sort of fulfill this revolution, we need to reinvent a lot of game design around AI. Based not drop AI into existing designs, but invent new designs. There's a lot of interesting stuff that can happen in the game production pipeline, particularly for current games. A lot of these like low-hanging fruits we just talked about. But for a bunch of the other things, we need to sort of reinvent game design around AI. We don't need to, but we can. There's an opportunity. No one has to do this, but yeah. We can go even further. We can talk about AI. This like, you know, you play with a modern LLM and you know that it's predicting the next word, but you can't help feeling that it's kind of an alien intelligence. How can we play with alien intelligence? And why? Because who knows? Who knows what we get? This is the more interesting reason for why. So now I'm first gonna dive into like what is this, what kind of things is gonna happen in the PCG space in particular. So a lot of games has for a very long time used some kind of procedural content generation. And this goes back to Elite from 1984 that had like 4,096 star systems with planets, space stations, prices of goods, space pirates, space police, quests, and so on, and fit in memory on a Commodore 64, which seems like utterly impossible, except that the star systems were generated as you enter them from a given fixed seed, sort of regenerated, to a bunch of other things, like Spelunky, so a modern roguelike, or not so modern anymore, from 2008. Dwarf Fortress, a very, very weird thing, like all these indie games that use PCG, but also things like Civilization series, for example, that are crucially built around PCG, would not be the same game if you did not have a new world generated every time you played. And what we've seen is this mainstreaming of like, a lot of games use some kind of PCG. Even, was it like some of the Dark Souls games have these kind of PCG dungeons as like an optional side thing and so on. It's a thing. And I think we can do a lot more with that. So part of my career has been devoted to how can we generate better game content. Now, game content, of course, is very different from generating images or text. It's both easier and harder. Easier because it often is generally lower resolution in some sense and more artificial in some sense. Harder because they don't just have to look good, they need to function. A level typically needs to, an image where one ear is a bit off just looks a bit silly, but it still can still look like a good image. A level which you cannot complete is broken and you can't play it. So for a while, I did a lot of work on using evolutionary algorithms to do things like evolving StarCraft maps and so on, and discovered a lot of interesting things, such as that good StarCraft players absolutely abhor the idea of having procedurally generated StarCraft maps, even if you can show that they're balanced. Interesting. From that, I concluded that StarCraft players are boring. The generation needs of and the game design are tightly connected. But you can kind of straightforwardly use evolutionary computation to generate a lot of things. It works. It's very controllable. You can guarantee playability and so on. But it's slow, which is why it's not used in runtime for very few games, I think. So what happened then was that the deep learning revolution came around, and then you saw like people using deep learning for all kinds of things, generating faces, recognizing faces, transforming faces, everything faces, and controlling robots and whatnot, playing Go. And why is it not in procedural content generation? Again, from the same Wired article, what do I explain somewhere? Just what I said. You can forgive generators that produce a face with wonky ears or some lines of gibberish text. But a broken game level, no matter how magical it looks, is useless. It's bullshit, Togelius says. You need to throw it out or fix it manually. And I'm just including this here because I like that I get Wired to sort of print a lot of semi-bad words, which is good. Swear at journalists, it pays back. The sort of technical way of saying this is that most game content are functional constraints. How can you use that with machine learning? How can you learn these functional constraints? Turns out that there are a lot of things you can do that is very simple. It's like shockingly simple machine learning in the sort of self-supervised learning space. Here's an old paper of ours that literally uses n-grams. So n-grams is the simplest possible statistical learning procedure you can think of. It's basically just like looking at conditional probabilities of characters to generate Super Mario Bros. Levels. And it works surprisingly well because the representation of the levels make it easy to do so. But you can do more complex things, and in particular, this is not controllable. One thing you can do is to control or to combine self-supervised learning with search mechanisms. So this is kind of a breakthrough paper from 2018, I think, led by Vanessa Volz, who is now with us at Model, and actually builds on an earlier paper of mine, but this kind of had a lot of impact. What it did here was to train generative adversarial networks, again, on the Super Mario Bros. Levels. Super Mario Bros. Is way overused in this research field because it's such a simple benchmark and the data is available and everybody can understand it, and there's like fast simulators and so on. You train the generative adversarial network on it, and then basically you search the latent space of the model. So the way to look at this is here is that you have a two-phase procedure. You get your levels, you encode them in tile space. These are the tile space encoding of the level we see here. And these are the real samples, and you have a generator that takes noise inputs, generates samples, and you train both the discriminator and the generator until the generator can make nice-looking Mario scenes. And then you use an evolutionary algorithm, in this case, covariance matrix adaptation evolution strategy, which is, you don't need to understand how it works, you can just get it out of a box. Search the latent space of the train generator for levels with particular properties. So and you can check these properties inside the search sort of inside the search loop. You can have an agent that plays the level, and then basically asks it like, is this playable for a level by an agent with particular properties, or does it have certain other properties in there? So basically, you can ask it for. This is what happens if you randomly sample from this space. It looks decent, but there's a couple of broken pipes and so on. And here's what happens. This space has a lot of locality. If you take this parent and sample in different ways, you get small variations of it. So you sort of, in this embedding space, you have like a smooth Mario scene space that you can explore. And here you ask it for like, hey, I want a playable level that's maximizing jumps. So basically in the fitness function of this algorithm, of the evolution algorithm, it had an agent playing through here, and the agent is just based on best first search, A star. And it figures out that this is a playable level with lots of jumps. And this one minimizes jumps. Here is an unplayable level. As you can see, you will die if you start here. And here you can ask it for like things like broken tiles and all kinds of stuff. So you get a very, very nice controllable generator once you've learned this space. You can then sequence them too in various ways. Now, just getting one level or one kind of scene at a time is nice, but maybe you want more than that. So there is this family of algorithms called quality diversity search algorithms. The poster child for this family of algorithms is called Map Elites. What it does here is that you can think of it as an optimization process where you don't optimize to find a single best example of something. You're trying to find a space of examples where each example is the best one within certain parameters. So here's an example here. Here's a performance, a fitness measure of something, and here are two features. So think like you want to evolve cars, and these cars are, this is gas consumption, and this is the top speed, and then basically what you want to evolve them for is like crash safety or something like this. And then basically what you have here is the top crash safety car within this particular range of gas consumption and top speed. And here's in another range you find the top one, so on. So basically you can find a nice distribution of best examples. They call elites here. So applying this thought of quality diversity search to searching the latent variable of train generators, you get this thing, we call it latent space illumination. And of course, this is broken. Here should be two different levels. What we get here is basically searching for Mario levels that have a number of different, here we have the path of Mario as well, that have like large numbers of high tiles, small numbers of high tiles, small numbers of enemies, large number of enemies. And the interesting part here is that this is the same, a single search gives you these levels. It actually gives you like 100 levels, for example, depending on how you set your elite. And then you can pick from the elites. Each one of them is provably good enough, or like in the sort of criteria you put in there with whatever constraints you have, and within certain a range of certain other kind of like certain other parameters. So this is a this is one of these extremely general approaches. It still takes some time to run this. You have like an inference time essentially. You have because a search takes. But then you have lots of level content you can just pick and choose from, or you can have an algorithm that somehow adaptively picks something that it thinks works for a particular player, and so on. So, very, very straightforward. You can also do, this is model AI work, where we did this with one of our customers for a puzzle game called Home and Garden Design Makeover. It's one of these matching tile games. And you can get lots of matching tile levels that basically have different mechanics or like have different sizes, have different difficulties based on with automatic playtesting and so on. So this is all based on the idea that you can first train on existing content learn a model and then search the model space somehow. The problem, of course, is that for many games, particularly if you're developing them, you don't have the content. So what if you have no training data? You only have one sad lemon here in a plastic bag. What do you... Life gives you lemons. Life gives you one lemon. What are you going to do? So you need some other machine learning approach to do this. You could use evolution, but evolution is slow in inference. So if you think about this, could you sort of change it so that you can train a model that gives you levels really, really fast, but that where you can put all the compute up front? Yes, you can. You can use reinforcement learning. So in this alternative approach, we called procedural content generation via reinforcement learning. This is not a nice slide. This is too many boxes and arrows in it. Basically, in reinforcement learning, you think of it as you're training an agent, for example, plays a game. And here you are training an agent, but the agent is not playing a game. It's generating parts of the game. It's a game designing agent in some way. Here is an example of this. If we go here, here is this agent, the train agent here is generating a simple dungeon game. It's like inspired by the overworld of Legend of Zelda. It has conditional inputs, so path length, what kind of path length we want, and distance to the nearest enemy. And let me see here. Yeah, this is the path length it actually has detected, and this is the one we want, and the distance to the nearest enemy. And you see this little red cursor here is scanning like an old monitor. It's like a CRT monitor. It's scanning across the level and rebuilding it in real time as you are giving it different inputs. And we've shown that these can be trained to be fairly generally capable. We are facing some limits to how scalable this is that we're trying to overcome, that basically training gets absurdly slow once you want really big content, but it works and it's quite reliable. We also have this in 3D. This is in Minecraft, a couple of different versions of this that basically scans in different ways. And we have explored a couple of different representations. So what it's doing here is building Minecraft dungeons, essentially, which basically we give it as an input a particular starting point, a particular finish point, and then tell it that between here you need to take so and so many steps, and it needs to be certain kind of treasures and enemies and so on in there, and it rebuilds this. It builds this 3D structure for you as you watch. Oh, you don't have to watch. It's actually quite fascinating. We've spent some time watching this and trying to figure out what has the agent actually learned, this trained level building agent. What's his strategy? It is surprisingly hard to sort of understand. You can also, this is using a standard proximal policy optimization, so PPO version, which is a kind of policy gradient to train these agents. You can combine what I said before about quality diversity search with something called neural cellular automata, which are smaller networks. You can think of them as convolutional networks with repeated layers that share weights, which is why they become pretty small. And then you can use these quality diversity algorithms I talked about before to generate a whole set of level generators. Like you can generate where each level generator generates an infinite amount of levels that have particular parameters. So this is literally kind of meta. you're not level generating levels, you're generating a large set of level generators, which each has particular properties in generated levels, and they're all very fast. So this is a slowed down example of one of the level generators in action. Have a look at what's happening here. So the neural cellular automata can be understood as like a weight repeating convolutional network. It can also be understood as a cellular automaton. And for those of you who know cellular automata, these are kind of weird beasts. So what it does here is that rewriting the whole level at once, that you see this flashing thing, and it's sort of creating this structure. And you see here towards the end, it's sort of iterating things back and forth. It's moving this key back and forth, moving the player character back and forth, the door is jumping around. And you see in the beginning, like at some point, the whole map is filled with player characters, and it uses this information to rebuild things. This is just a loop. In practice, if you watch this and give it slightly different seeds, it will give you like an endless variety of levels, all solvable. It's very fast, and it is very hard to figure out what it is actually doing. But it's working well. Next thing, as I'm anyway talking about stuff I don't understand. Well, the last one I understood how we got here. Now we're getting into some current work from one of my PhD students, Sam Earle, and text-guided 3D Minecraft generation. So we're trying to do text-guided conditioning, because in the previous examples, you had to basically you have to hand specify these are the parameters, this is path length, this is like X and Y dimension, and so on. Here, we're trying to sort of give it a text like, hey, give me a Super Mario Bros. Level in Minecraft, and then the model goes around and gives you something like this, is the goal. What we're using here, something called a neural radiance field, a NeRF, to create a 3D grid. And we're doing that on top of like a 3D shape generator, an existing 3D shape generator. And we're discretizing this grid. We're training the discretization and the NeRF based on the final output, and we're also propagating through in the current version certain constraints. So we also give it certain constraints. You want your level to, you're building a house, and you want like you can never have water floating on top in the air, or like you cannot have certain objects on top of others. And we're working to integrate various kind of path lengths, considerations, and so on. But basically, as a diagram here, basically, get this grid vertex, and we have two different pipelines of discretization for solids and air blocks, and then we combine those. Results are not perfect yet, but you can generate Minecraft structures such as a pizza and a fork and a tray on a table, which is exactly the Minecraft world you always wanted to play. A pile of crab is seasoned and well-cooked. and some other stuff from Planet Minecraft. It's a pretty large, this large medieval ship is pretty nice, except that it's not actually ship-shaped. It's sort of, the shape is kind of wrong, but the old Wizard's Tree Mansion Series 2 Build 1 redescription, with all of this text is taken from this Planet Minecraft database, gives a pretty nice 3D structure, I think. And we're working on getting the functional constraints in there. So this is a paper that we hope to be able to put out soon. And I'm particularly excited about this thing that separates this from kind of generic 3D generation, the fact that we can put these functional constraints in it. Right. Another method that actually requires some data, but not a lot of data, is something we call the path of destruction. The path of destruction is an idea we had several years ago, and then which is that basically you can take small levels and destroy them, like basically randomly replace various blocks with others, but you keep a track of all the ways you destroy it. In each level or game object or something can be destroyed in an essentially infinite number of ways. So from very little game data, you can get a lot of training data, which is very nice if you, for example, only have 5 levels and you want to have 100. And so basically, you learn to repair, and then you sort of create new levels by giving it random inputs and see how it repairs its way into a new level. This, as people pointed out to us after we had put out a first archive version of a paper, people pointed out that this is similar to diffusion models, and we were like, damn, it's similar to diffusion models. We honestly didn't even think about that. It's different though, because this is a sequential discrete process, and pre-diffusion models are parallel and continuous. Diffusion models are also very data hungry. This is not data hungry at all. So this is level generators that can generate an infinite amount of these levels based on as little as one, training on as little as one level. They're very, very sort of nice with the amount of data it needs. And some experiments we have for 3D generation, scaling this up to bigger sizes, show that these actually keep working. And this slide ended up over here, right. So recent paper we put out seeing if we can do level generation with large language models. Because levels are 2D or 3D structures, but you can always see it as a string. Everything is a string in the end in computer science, right? You can, but interestingly, to summarize the very many different results we have, is that smaller language models like GPT-2 overfit terribly. And this is Sokoban levels, so they're very small, but they're quite puzzly, so they're hard to design well. A random level is typically not playable at all, so the generator needs to understand some of the functional constraints. Yeah? Yes. Yes. No. There is. We tried with and without pre-training. So pre-trained GPT-2, pre-trained on language. It's not clear whether the pre-training helps or not. The results had a very high variance here, there were a bit of a roller coaster ride. However, when you pre-train or when you fine-tune the GPT-3, which is pre-trained on a lot of language, on these. It is surprisingly much more data efficient and overfits much less. It clearly is so that the pre-training really, really helps here. Even though the pre-training has no levels in it, as far as we know, just a lot of English and computer code. I need to shut up. I was going to say something about co-designing with humans, the mixed initiative part, but I want to talk about game testing as well. So this is a recent project called Baba is Y'all, using the famous Finnish game Baba is You, and we made a distributed level generation design thing, where you basically can go into a website, design your own Baba is You levels. You can also generate them, ask the generator to generate them, using and a testing agent to play them. The interesting thing here is that the system, as you can see here, basically gives you, if you want to, a list of, using the same kind of map elite structure before, behind the scenes, it gives you a list of levels with particular properties that no one has designed yet and asks you to design them for it. So we're trying to explore the mixed initiative part here, where basically the system is not just your tool, but it is also asking you for things like, hey, how about you design this thing? So kind of like, and creativity works well within constraints, right? So it gives you constraints to be creative within, and then it goes back into this big shared level repository. And I think this is one of the multiple ways in which you can use AI in a mixed initiative way in large collaborative settings. Here's a project that basically, this video compressed very badly, sorry for this, which basically is trying to automatically generate tutorials. I won't dig into this because we're running out of time. Towards the end, back to game testing. I mentioned before that game testing, people are starting to explore automated game testing, but we're not quite there. There are a lot of things you could do for game testing. You could try to use reinforcement learning. We have published a bit about that. The Electronic Arts Seed team have also published about this, and several others. Thing is that reinforcement learning is very slow to train. Like, it basically requires you to have these huge server farms. Doesn't generalize well, policies tend to be quite narrow. It only does certain things. In game testing, it's important you actually get coverage. You try doing a whole bunch of different things. So you basically need a lot of different playing. Imitation learning. It's not as slow as reinforcement learning, but it needs data. And you have the chicken and egg problem here. If you want to do game testing, new game level or new game mechanic, you typically don't have that gameplay data yet. And it's hard to generalize. Eventually, hopefully, we can generalize. One of the things we want to get to in model AI are these kind of imitation learned foundation models that would generalize between different games, at least within a genre. But that's a story for another day. Tree search, like Monte Carlo tree search, potentially augmented with clever sort of evaluation functions. It's great. It's very pliable. It's very nice if you have really fast forward models. Most game engines do not allow for this. Or like, game engines are not built with fast forward models in mind. You cannot forward simulate very fast. Exploration algorithms. Think Go Explore, if you know this, and other algorithms that basically try to explore, build a graph of game states that are as separate from each other as possible. This is the path we are currently taking with our main product model AI, because it's fast. It needs you to be able to reset state, but it doesn't need to be super, the state reset doesn't need to be super fast. They don't actually play well. They're not good at playing the game, but they're good at being very diverse in play styles. So for many types of games, it works. So this is an example from our academic side here about play testing with Monte Carlo tree search, where we evolved different sort of evaluation expansion functions for the MCTS to implement a number of different personas that play the same game in many different ways. And this works well and is fast and so on, but requires that you can simulate your game really fast enough. So this doesn't actually work to build something to sell to game companies. So a couple of comments here about this game company. I'm here with both my academic hat on and my startup co-founder hat. Here's an extremely compressed story about what happened with our company. We started this company because we thought that working in academia, it's really hard to work with the game industry because, let's say, structural problems on both sides. That's the nice and diplomatic way, because otherwise I would have to insult both sides of the room here. But structural problems on both sides. We wanted to build this founded startup to bring some of this research into the game industry. And we had a lot of what we thought were great ideas for things we could build from customers that customers were interested in and willing to pay, at least willing to pay a bit for. Maybe it's not as much as we wanted. So we built and shipped things in player experience modeling. We built and shipped level generators, including for Candy Crush. We built and shipped multiplayer team bots and a couple of things. But none of this generalizes because all these games are so different from each other, and it's extremely annoying. And game engines are not our friend. They make everything much harder for us. So we needed something we can actually build a nice reusable product on. And it took us years to sort of find something. So this is basically what we do. Jesus. Sorry for the Scottish. We'll get back to it. So basically, this is our current main product. It's not the only thing we do. We're also working on the imitation learning to foundation model path. But our current product is this like exploration bot based sort of game testing plugin that plays your game, generates reports about where everything goes wrong.
With Model Test, developers can enhance their quality assurance by covering more ground faster than ever before. Using our intelligent AI bots, you can achieve weeks of testing in just a few hours, with full reporting on where bugs are lurking in your game and how to reproduce them. Our AI testers don't require training to get started. They just need to know what types of events or glitches you're looking to catch. Using our extensive tools provided in the Model AI API, you can identify what information each bot records and the types of errors, be it specific API exceptions or stack trace errors. If you're looking to catch the game doing something that it shouldn't, you can define your own custom events, and with a little bit of extra code, you can report these events to our testing tools. Once your game build is ready, set it up for testing, and after completion, we provide a full breakdown on how many bugs were discovered, what the issues were, the relevant engine logs when they happened, and how the bot found them, plus additional insights into overall CPU and memory performance up to the point of failure. Model Test enables for thousands of bots testing your game at once. By speeding up testing, we can let developers focus on what you do best, making great games.
So, this voice here was from Tommy Thompson, who runs the AI and Games YouTube channel, and he's our voice, because he has this much nicer accent than I have. And anyway. This was the end of this talk. Towards the end, I usually show this slide with, like, here's a popular science book that I wrote so that my parents would understand what I do. I can confirm that my parents have read it. I'm not sure they understand what I do. Here is a textbook on artificial intelligence and games by myself and Yorgos Yannakakis that is a couple of years out of date now, so 2018, but still kind of good, I would say, but I'm kind of not unbiased here. We also every year run this summer school on AI for games at this address over here. So this year we're running it at the end of June in Cambridge, UK. And this is for both industry and academia and so on. We usually have a bunch of great speakers, and also we speak ourselves, but mostly the other speakers are great. So it's highly recommended, I would say. And that's it. Thank you.
We have time for questions. Officially, the time was until 4, but we have some time, so if you can stay and ask questions, feel free, and I'll give you the microphone, or probably you can also just shout out, and Julian, if you can repeat the question.
Yeah.
The video. There in the back.
I'll just shout. I would like to ask you about the AI playtesting service. What's your target?
So what's the target audience of the Model AI playtesting services? Small to medium, mostly. We want it to work up onto, like, you know, big AAA games, but hopefully in 3 weeks or so, we should be launching a version of this that you can actually download yourself and install as a Unity plugin, Unreal to plugin to come later. So it should be working on a shoestring budget, yes.
Anyone else?
Should I shout? Hey. So one of the motivations you gave for procedural generation methods was to unlock sort of creativity by getting rid of boring work. I'm just wondering how validated that claim is, you know, according to the industry people.
Yes. So Kate Compton, who is a person, I don't know, people may be aware of her. She was one of the speakers at the summer school last year. She's done some cool PCG work herself, actually a lot of cool PCG work. She's also a vocal critic of PCG hype. We love having our little sparring matches now and then. She's phrased what she calls the 10,000 bowls of oatmeal problem. You can generate 10,000 bowls of oatmeal, and they're all technically different, but they all look oatmeal, like oatmeal, and it's extremely boring. This is a risk, yes. You can create generators that don't help you with anything, and they don't sort of, you know, And yeah, it doesn't make the game more fun. It doesn't take away any of the Rudge work. I think the claim is well validated for certain kinds of content. It's well validated for like speed tree, dust vegetation. It's fine. No one wants to do that. For other kind of like, you know, first pass of a landscape or something like this. apart from that, it depends on your mileage. It very much depends on what kind of game you're developing. Some see it more as like a particular aesthetic, the generative aesthetic. But I would say that often it's more of a binary. It's like certain kinds of games would not be possible at all without like without sort of procedural content generation. Is there a follow-on question to this?
Like yes, I have some follow-up. So I see that there's certain sort of shift of focus from these boring asset generation to sort of a higher levels of abstractions when it comes to designing games. Maybe you want to talk more about like, I don't know, think more about storytelling or think more about, you know, atmosphere rather than having these boring generation stuff. So that I understand, but sort of a tangential topic here that
a brief comment on this. I think there's two dimensions here. One is the level of abstraction of your description.
Right.
And the other is the level of functional requirements that the game content has. Like, you know, making vegetation, all of it has very low level of functionality requirement, but it can go all the way from like very specific, make this branch, to like, hey, give me a sort of an atmospheric forest where trolls could live over there, you know, so you could do both, but then you can sort of move at all quadrangles here, really, sort of, and there's a lot of this we don't know how to do yet.
Yeah, on that point, sort of, I mean, we're unsure about the optimal place where procedural generation can sort of maximally automate things while retaining authorship for content creators, for example. And I mean, you know, there's certain hype and fear about replacing human game designers with these procedural techniques. But in your opinion, does this, you know, all these techniques that you mentioned, do these fundamentally aim to somehow augment human capacity, you know, and increase the limit of the bandwidth, the limit of the creative, you know, processes rather than to replace them? What do you think?
So I have different answers to this question depending on what mood I'm in. You know, if I'm pissed off at people and slightly drunk. But now I'm very nice and everybody's friend, so I'm going to say it's all about augmenting human creativity. The real answer to this question is that it really depends on what you're doing, depends on what you're building, and what it's really dependent from game production to game production, what kind of needs of content you have. So, of course, you can think of like a game production pipeline where you would have humans that would get replaced in an algorithm, but then you're not using humans well.
Thanks for the talk. So I wanted to ask, one thing you touched on was the generalizability of a lot of these approaches to different types of games. And I think that's one of the things that's stopping a lot of studios in industry from adopting this sort of stuff. So in your opinion, what needs to change for these techniques to be more generalizable?
What's happened? Okay. We have a... Ricardo Cisnet, who is one of our lead engineers, gave a talk again at our summer school last year, and we have a paper in preparation on this, on what would a game engine look like that actually supported AI. And one of the things that would, in particular for the bots and playtesting sort of side of things, like NPCs, playtesting bots and all the kind of things, you would rebuild game engines. You would basically... ideally, rebuild game engine up and to basically separate, basically follow classic good software engineering, MVC framework, basically. Separate the logic from the animation and a bunch of other things, make fast forward models possible, things like this. Game engines are unfortunately not built this way. You could also think about like much higher level abstractions for game mechanics and game objects and so on. And that would also make a lot of these things possible, at least in the testing and bot side. For the PCG side, it's actually harder, which is why I do a lot of academic research on PCG, but Model does not have a PCG product. The kind of standardization and shared language and shared abstractions we would need to make PCG that worked across many different games in functional aspects, it's actually quite hard. I'm not really sure how to get there. We would first need to get to the point where we have like bots that could work across many different games, and then move to like you know PCG that that could work across different games that are built on bot testing, for example. I don't see that happening anytime soon, unless someone wants to make a fresh start and build the game engine and ecosystem and everything from the ground. But that doesn't mean that you can't make nice evolutionary or machine learning based content generators for specific games. You definitely can. But then you need to have the expertise in-house or like hire consultants for that particular thing. So yeah, I wish I had a better answer to that. Or more positive, maybe. Yeah?
Yes.
You have mentioned that currently we are bound with templates and genres that were invented before machine learning was widely spread. Mm-hmm. And currently things are going to be changed and new genres would be invented. Any ideas about what could they be?
Yeah, so you have another hour? I kind of want to... So this is it's a couple of years old, actually, where we tried to sort of explore this. Call it AI-based game design patterns. It's like one of these short papers. Oh, oopsie, sorry. AI-based game design patterns is one, this is 2015, so this is ages ago. And basically, this guy is now at Blizzard, right? I don't know. We're looking into like where it could take place, where you could foreground interesting AIs as visualized, as something you can interact with as a role model, as a trainee. That's a little bit like black and white, and as a classic game, and in many games like this. Here's a nice thing. It's like AI is editable. You actually sort of edit the sort of the behavior of something somehow as a co-creator, as an adversary, as a villain, as a spectacle. We went into this for a bit, and I've sort of, so I'm not going to dig into like, there's a lot here, but since LLMs have become a thing, there's a lot of people that focus on this particular thing, and I think there's a lot of interesting design work that could be done into how you could have LLMs that sort of act, that power NPCs, but with the current game designs, it just won't work because they will flat out lie and bullshit and refer to things that don't exist and so on. So how do you build around this in different ways? How do you design around bullshitting NPCs, unreliable NPCs and so on? So there's a lot of interesting design challenges here. And even with existing capabilities before that. So yeah, that will take us too far to dig into, but I'm happy to keep discussing this in smaller groups afterwards.